So all I have to share with you today is a student's insight. It's something that I learned when I was a student of anthropology at LSE. I was working in the anthropology department, and this was a cognitive anthropology class taken by the HOD, Rita Astuti, who I'm forever indebted to for introducing me to this idea. So I can't but sort of share it with you, because to me it speaks really to the roots of what it means perhaps to be interdisciplinary. So cognitive anthropology, as in, can we put the slides on? So let me begin in any case, and the slides will come on when they do. So cognitive anthropology, if you are familiar enough with it, or the disciplines that it's composed on, of, is already a kind of oxymoron, right? So anthropology, as some of you know, is invested in the cultural or in the social. Anthropologists believe that social and cultural forces are sort of... Sorry? Yeah, I have the clicker. Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay, wow. So anthropologists are really invested in the social and in the cultural, and they think that social and cultural forces shape our kind of lived experiences, and no self-respecting anthropologist would be sort of caught dead giving any importance to the individual, let alone the individual brain, right? So cognitive anthropology immediately is sort of attacking foundations of a discipline. The cognitive anthropologists are a rather unpopular group within the anthropology departments, as you can imagine, because they're sort of trying to do this little dance between anthropology and its enemy discipline, psychology. But what I'm going to try to do with you today is talk to you about a cognitive anthropology concept, and see how that might make us think a little bit harder about how we understand disciplines in the first place. So the concept I'm going to be talking to you about is something called theory of mind, right? But before that, I want to kind of run a bit of a test on you, and it would be great if you could give me responses. So if I came here and I gave you a kind of a box of Smarties, and I said, what's inside this box? What would you say? Smarties, right? Very good, excellent. And then I opened the box of Smarties, and I showed you that no, there are no Smarties in this box, there are pencils, right? You'd say, oh, acha, okay. And I closed the Smarties box and I put it away. Professor Madhvi Menon isn't in this auditorium, but suppose she just walks in, right? And she comes and sits here, and I take the Smarties box out again. And instead of asking Professor Menon, I ask you, if I show Professor Menon this box, what do you think she'll say is inside it? Now, things get a little complicated because it's Professor Menon. But what do you think she'd say? As in, don't use your brains too much on this one. What do you think she'd say is inside the box? Smarties, right? Excellent. Because you know that she doesn't know that there are actually pencils inside it, right? So what you've been able to do is that you've been able to put yourself inside Professor Menon's head, as scary as that sounds, and you've been able to impute what her responses might be, right? And cognitive scientists would say that this is you using your theory of mind. Right? So you've been able to enter someone else's mind and make guesses on their behalf, right? You've been able to step into their cognitive shoes, in a sense. Okay, so that was all the... So theory of mind, definitionally then, refers to a largely automatic, unconscious way in which we construe other people and ourselves as psychological agents, agents with minds and agents with mental states. Using theory of mind, when one uses one's theory of mind, it means that one can go beyond another person's surface behavior in order to see this kind of this host of invisible mental states, such as desires, intentions, goals, knowledge, true and false beliefs that motivate the behavior that we were sort of observing on the surface, right? And possessing this faculty allows us to do a lot of stuff that we perhaps take for granted. Some of the most sophisticated things we do because we have a theory of mind is telling lies, for example, right? I'm not going to stop to explain this to you, but you can sort of figure out why. We can appreciate art, perhaps, because we have theories of mind. We can synthesize arguments because we have theories of mind, etc., etc. A lot of communication happens only because of theory of mind. You understand, right? We take this for granted, but it's only because we can sort of put ourselves in another person's cognitive shoes that we can continue having a conversation with someone, right? Or come back and have a conversation with them after some time. So this is a fairly basic concept, right? But what becomes interesting is when we think of what the implications of this concept can be. So research is kind of currently underway, but cognitive scientists believe that theory of mind is something that only human beings possess, right? There were lots of tests done on chimpanzees, but it's sort of concluded that what looks like theory of mind in chimpanzees is probably just learned behavior that they're kind of mimicking or sort of learning through some kind of conditioning or us anthropomorphizing them, right? It's not that they have theories of mind. So it's a fundamentally human thing, apparently, right? And all humans have it. And in a sense, this is something really like fundamentally human about all of us. And at this point, my anthropological hackles kind of go up a little bit, right? Because what do you mean by fundamentally human? What counts as fundamentally human? Where is the kind of cross-cultural variation in all of this? Is there a cross-cultural variation? Have these cognitive scientists bothered to find out whether or not there is a cross-cultural variation? How can we go about finding out what happens, right? And there are all kinds of studies being conducted, and I'm going to introduce you to a few of these studies. So cognitive scientists in Budapest have been sort of designing something called Smurf studies, which sounds pretty cool. It has something to do with a tennis ball, an opaque screen, and a Smurf. And I'm not going to go into the details of it, but the Smurf studies concluded that whether human beings want to or not, they find themselves entangled in the cognitive or mental processes of another person. Which is to say that the theory of mind seems to be spontaneous and automatic, not something we do intentionally, something that happens in any case, right? It's not something we can consciously control. We just step into other people's minds and figure stuff out on their behalf. Right after that, I want to introduce you to, I want to introduce you to a community of people called the Urapmin, who live in Papua New Guinea. Where is Papua New Guinea? Huh? The Pacific. Okay, that's good. When I asked one of my YF students, they said it was in Africa because that's where all the tribes live, clearly. So Papua New Guinea has this community of people called the Urapmin. Also other communities called the Korowai and the Bosavi, who practice something that anthropologists, in response to theory of mind, have been calling opacity of mind, right? So what happens in the Urapmin is that you're morally forbidden to enter someone's mind, right? They understand the mind and the internal organs as too unstable to sort of be counted on, right? So you're morally prohibited from entering, so from compromising someone's, say, psychic privacy, right? So from when you're a kid, you're sort of taught this kind of stuff. So if I see Shubhangi in front of me, I look at Shubhangi and I go to someone else and say, you know, Shubhangi is feeling sad. If I was in the Urapmin, my mother would come and give me one tight slap and say, how dare you say Shubhangi is sad? Shubhangi is not sad. There's water coming out of her eyes. You cannot enter her mind and assume that this is sadness, right? So in a way, the people in the Urapmin are conditioned to do exactly the opposite of what theory of mind is, right? So this is where things become interesting. So if theory of mind is an automatic, spontaneous ability that all human beings have, do you think the Urapmin will have it in a degree that is more or less than other people in the world because they're conditioned that way? Or do you think that just because they're kind of talking about it differently doesn't mean they've really kind of changed, right? And this is a test that's trying to be, as in this is a study that's being conducted right now. So what's happening is that these Budapest people who design Smurf studies are sort of creating a culturally appropriate version of this study, and they're taking it to the Udapmin to kind of run it on them to see what happens. Basically to see whether the cognitive scientists win or the anthropologists win, right? And this is a really heated debate and something that we should sort of talk about in this context for sure. So what do you think will happen? Do you think the cognitive scientists are right? And that just because we kind of talk about things differently or culturally we behave in a particular way doesn't mean that we fundamentally sort of change at the level of our bodies? Or do you think that culture has the capacity to do this kind of stuff, right? Different groups of you will think different things because we've already been sort of poached on by specific disciplines, right? After you're 18, this is already happening. And we spend the rest of our lives, if we decide to be academics, sort of defending these camps. And so this is an interesting question to ask. And what's happening is that there's more and more research to show that it's not biology or culture, but, and this is a term I learned in Madhvi Menon's literature class, it's neither and both, right? So it's a co-evolution of biology and culture. And that's slightly difficult to wrap your head around because of the way in which we understand how this kind of stuff works, right? So the body is fundamental, the gene is fundamental, and if culture has something to do with it, it sort of neatly decorates itself on top of the gene, right? But what's happening when we sort of think of the coevolution of culture and biology seriously is that we're forced to think of a kind of interweaving that isn't hierarchized. And we have to think about how culture is entering our bodies and reproducing itself genetically, right? And the fact that I'm saying genetically as genetically and not just genetically already betrays my kind of Macaulay-esque education and the epistemic violence that it has inflicted on me. It has everything to do with my relatives who shudder when they hear that my sister is a math and physics major in science. And when they said, oh, so what are you doing? I say, anthropology. And they say, bah, 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 very good. My father was also a great anthropologist. So, but we need to take that stuff seriously, because what does that do to how we understand disciplines and the claims that they make? And what's so cool about genes in any case, right? Why have we decided that they're fundamental? And at this point, okay, so why do we look at it in this way rather than this way or that way? That was just me going a little berserk on Microsoft Paint. But I just asked you why we took genes so seriously in the first place. Last year in October, there was a study to show that people in Melanesia actually have a DNA that isn't human, right? What do we do with that? What do we do with that? Do we now decide that the Melanesians, these people, are less human than us, or slightly less human than us, or more originally human than us? As in, how do we hierarchize this kind of stuff? And which discipline do we let decide this kind of stuff for us, right? Should we let anthropology decide? Should we let cognitive science decide? Can I let literature decide? Why are we so hell-bent on the gene, on cells, right? Why is it that a fundamental right or a human right is first and foremost an individual right? Why is it that my body ends where my physical body ends, right? Who's to say that a part of me isn't, say, sitting next to Manisha scoffing at my own pretentiousness right now, right? Who decided that this is where my body ended, right? So again, does anthropology decide? Does cognitive science decide? Can literature decide? Is metaphysics going to decide? Or is a group of white men sitting somewhere else going to decide for me, right? And I only say this half jokingly, of course. And my current answer to this, and this is something that keeps changing, my current answer is they can all decide. What's the problem with that? There's no problem with them deciding. That's what disciplines do. They come up with rigidities, they come up with claims based on these rigidities, and they make those claims. They create discourse, and that's fine, that's really cool. The jhamela happens when someone comes and starts hierarchizing these disciplines, right? And then we need to think a little bit carefully on about who gets to hierarchize these disciplines and on what basis are they doing this kind of stuff, right? How much time do I have left? No, on that basis, I'm going to continue. How much time do I have left? Huh? 5 to 7 minutes. Okay, that's really great. So on what basis do... So who's going to decide this kind of hierarchy of disciplines? So at this point, I want to sort of come back to what I was saying about this kind of co-evolution of culture and biology after sort of talking to you a little bit about how we're so sort of resistant to accept that this kind of stuff happens and the kind of the powers at work that sort of prevent us from doing so. And I want to introduce you to this study by an anthropologist called Richard Eaves on the Lillet. Also in Papua New Guinea, and that's quite interesting that all three of these kind of remarkable examples that we've spoken about come from Papua New Guinea. Are anthropologists sort of looking in the same place for exciting stuff is also a question that we can ask perhaps. And the Lillet in Papua New Guinea are particularly interesting because amongst themselves, and this is not now, this is some time ago, they decided that women possess this kind of gravitational force within them that made them heavy, right? So women were more suited to doing things sitting down, for example, chopping vegetables, cleaning the floor, et cetera, because it was in their body. That's what their body did. Their bodies were heavy. And men were sort of lithe, and they were really good at jumping around and dancing and climbing trees, et cetera, and because of these sort of forces that existed within them, there was a kind of division of labor as well that happened, right? So women and girls were sort of born into that community being told that this is how their bodies operated, and that they were heavy, and they were being sort of drawn down to the earth, et cetera. And then what happened is that Christian missionaries arrived at Papua New Guinea, and they sort of built their church, and they brought men and women into the church, and they taught them hymns, and they introduced music, and then they introduced dance. And then things became interesting because the women refused to dance. They said, we can't dance. Our body can't move this way, right? And they were like, what's wrong with you? We can all dance. God has made our bodies in the same way, etc., etc. And so music was put on, and this is a video that I saw some time ago. I haven't been able to find it, but it was so moving to see women dance for the first time in their lives and move in ways that they never imagined they could. And it was enthralling for them and for someone who had to watch. And that was wonderful for the women of the Lillet. And suddenly they said, oh God, we can do all of this stuff. And that means we can do everything that men can. That's so cool. And then there's this wonderful little anecdote of this brother and sister. And the sister decided to challenge the brother to a race. And she just found all the power that's been lying latent in her body all of this time, et cetera, et cetera. And they decided to run a race, and the brother won. And so she tried again, and the brother won again. And she said, okay, fine, running is not working, let's do a tree climbing race. And the brother won again, right? So the brother kept winning. And the sister never won. And that sort of kind of kept replicating itself in sort of brother-sister duos, men-women duos everywhere. And they found that no matter how hard they tried, there were certain things that women's bodies weren't capable of, right? Why does that happen? And what does that have to do with the fact that historically and culturally, our musculature has evolved in a particular way? Right? For years and years and years, certain muscles in a certain group of people, for whatever reason, haven't been allowed to develop in a particular way. And now, how much sense does it make to say that men and women are equal? Is it even equality that we should be looking for, right? Or is it difference that we should learn to recognize? Who decides what counts as a similarity and what counts as a difference? Who decides what counts as evidence? Why are we so hell-bent on evidence? And this might be veering towards a little bit of science bashing, which I really, really don't want to do, because scientists are wonderful people. But as a, they're really, really cool. Two of my favorite people in the world are scientists. One, of course, turned into an anthropologist, but that's all right. That was my doing, I think. So scientists are fine. As a wannabe anthropologist, my only problem is with why the discourse around science has suddenly been rendered so sacred and untouchable. Who decides that I can't ask these questions? And it's only perhaps in a kind of interdisciplinary space that I will be allowed to. And what thinking interdisciplinarily has allowed me to do is, or taught me to do at least, is to not be so hell-bent on the truth, right? It's taught me to start thinking instead about why something counts as the truth, or why something doesn't count as the truth. And perhaps most significantly, why it is that we so desperately need the truth in our lives. Thank you.